Well, you have the right way of inviting people. I thought this was just a fun way to put that little seed in there. Yeah, there's a lot of different ways we can approach people with this, but just know that Easter is a-coming. It's next Sunday, and so it changes things a bit around here, even for this service here. It's a very exciting time of year. There are a couple weeks a year where we do get a lot of extra visitors, more than we normally do. We get lots of family members who don't know our campus so well, and so next week, please engage and invite if you see the opportunity. You'll be surprised who will say yes, and just know that. But also know we have an extra service next week at 8 o'clock in the morning in the chapel if you want to get started early on that day, or your family likes those early services. There'll be communion at the 8 o'clock service, not at the others, but there'll be one there. So if something family and friends you want them to experience, we're doing that. We're doing Sunday school. It may not look like a normal Sunday school, but we're going to offer Sunday school, so we'll have stuff for the kids. And, of course, the parking lot will look a little different. You may not be able to park in your same slot. The chairs might be filled, but that's okay, right? Because on top of that, I know you all are so friendly. I mean, just looking at you, I just want to come up and say hi and hear your story. And like we normally do every Sunday, if we see people and we don't know them and they look at us, we smile and we say, how are you doing? And if they look confused, we go up and figure out where they need to go, like every Sunday. And it's just a wonderful thing. And you may have to belly up, is what my grandfather used to say. That meant you'll have to get close to each other in the chairs. It's okay. I see a few guys here. They're all right. If you sit by them, they'll be okay. And so wonderful thing coming up next week. A great celebration. Be here. I absolutely love it. Actually, the celebration starts today, and then we kind of do stuff during the week. And then there's another great celebration next week. So just be mindful of that. Invite people and enjoy. Now the more important part, our word.
A reading from the book of Matthew. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. Go into the village over there, he said. As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied to there with its colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, the Lord needs them, and he will immediately let you take them. This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, tell the people of Jerusalem, look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey's colt. The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt to him and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, praise God for the Son of David! Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Praise God in highest heaven! The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. Who is this? They asked. And the crowds replied, it's Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth in Galilee. This is God's word.
Let us pray. Dear Lord and Savior, we pray this day that your word would not be bound, but run its free course, that we would understand your truth, and by the work of the Spirit, carry it out into a desperate world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, to begin with, baseball is a brutal sport. It is absolutely brutal. This is what you call a game of failure. And my son has been involved in this sport his entire life, and he's going to go on to play it when he goes to school. This sport is absolutely brutal. And you want to know why? Because if you do something good one out of four times, they consider you a good player. If you do something good one out of three times, you become a pro baseball player someday. If you continue to do that, and I have to tell you, I've been around some professional athletes. I've been around baseball players at the MLB level. I've been around a lot of college baseball players. Do you know what they're like? Those people are almost freaks of nature. They are incredible athletes. Hand-eye coordination, extra strength, muscles where they need to have it. They were born to do this. And yet, when all the kids are younger, it seems, including me at times, you think every one of your kids are going to grow up to be these pro athletes. They are just the best thing, and we just need to encourage them, and they're going to grow, and they're going to do all these great things. And so not only is this sport brutal, man, can you imagine a parent watching it? It's just as hard on us, sitting on the other side of the fence, watching the kids struggle. My son at times, and baseball isn't one of those sports either where you have four attempts every game, and one out of every one of those games you do something good. You can go days, games, weeks without doing anything good in the sport and still be considered pretty good. And so the mental just brutality of the sport. Why do kids do it? And then the parents suffer right with them. Well, there was one day where my son had gone through one of those streaks and was not doing good in his eyes. And boy, he was about ready to resign from the human race. It was ready just to quit everything. I mean, and I remember praying as a parent, why do you torture my kid? Why can't they? And you're seeing this. So we were both not happy at the time. And it was at Keystone, and it was during sort of a time period where we were the only game. And then as we were walking away, we noticed something else happening on the other side of the field that we didn't plan on. We have a member here. His name is Marshall. And he's a wonderful kid. And him and many of his friends are part of something called the Challengers League. These are kids or individuals who have disabilities. Disabilities physically, oftentimes also disabilities with their mind. And so they have developed a program called the Challengers League where they get all of these wonderful kids together and they get to play ball. We had never went. But I did notice they had St. Louis Cardinal jerseys on one of the teams. So you know something good's about to happen, being the best team ever. And so when we looked across there, we just wanted to see what was going on. And so as we got close, I realized, this is Marshall's team. They're playing. And so my dejected son and me, a heavily praying dad that wasn't getting answers, walked over to this game going on. And it was absolutely incredible. Some were in wheelchairs, some couldn't speak, some had just couldn't see, some couldn't hear, it was just an incredible collection of baseball players, but they had really nice jerseys and they got to play on the field. And what was so wonderful is they would toss a softball in, and until something successful happened, they kept throwing the ball. And I'm telling you, it didn't take long for something wonderful to happen. They'd either hit it or swing or move it, and they would run, and they would pursue the ball. And it was so wonderful because after each good thing that happened, and there were many, everyone celebrated. Everyone cheered. Everyone felt the joy of what was going on. It was a celebration of life. They weren't worried about their stats. They're not worried about a scholarship. They're not worried about building a resume. They weren't worried about looking good or wearing the right gear. They could care less. All they wanted to do was to get on the field. We watched about two innings of this, just sucked up into the joy and what was going on. And I was thinking this, and Mark, I hope, you know, he is my kid, thought about the same time I did. And he turned to me, and he said something very profound, and it stuck with him for all of his life so far anyway. Dad, you know, those are real baseball players. You know, that's the genuine, that's the real deal. They know this is a game. And they go out there, and all they want to do is play. And every time something good happens, they celebrate. They don't think about how this impacts their stats or any of this. They love getting on the jersey, and they're on that field. And that's what they love. It was an incredible, joyous event. And whenever Mark, or even I, get to that point in this brutal, miserable sport, this game of failure, we both go back to that game. We both go back to those kids, Marshall, because they loved life and they celebrated it every chance they got. That is a gift. And it doesn't take long to realize that's the genuine article. That's what a true baseball player looks like. That's how they act. And so Mark and I would treasure that moment. We would just take it with us. And to this day, he still uses those moments. Today we come upon this incredible celebration of life. No, we don't have baseballs that we're throwing in the air and swinging around. That's probably bad. But for us, it is a celebration of Jesus Christ coming to us. It is a celebration of life itself. And we say, Hosanna! Some Bible versions I like, some I don't. This one didn't use Hosanna, so I'm going to make sure we say it a lot. Hosanna! Hosanna! And we see the kids come through, and you know why you smile? Because you see a genuine expression of their feelings. That ain't made up. Half of them are scared to death. The other half don't know what to do. That's a genuine product, and we smile and we embrace it because it's true, it's authentic in an otherwise different world. Jesus came, and it is a time for us to celebrate. But not just this day or this week. I said in the video jokingly that we really only celebrate, we only give us permission to celebrate as a church twice a year a little bit, right? We have this Easter celebration, we have this Christmas celebration. But Jesus gives us a chance to celebrate every day of our life, to celebrate life itself in the everyday, ordinary occurrences of our life, because He's with us. He came. And so let's celebrate together. Let's see how we can celebrate every day by looking at what Jesus has done. We start off with this. We can celebrate every day because He gave Himself to us. God gave Himself to us. It goes all the way back to Exodus, all the way back to the beginning of the Ten Commandments. I am the Lord. I am the God of all. I am everything. I am the Creator. I am all powerful. I am the I am. And then what did He say? I am the Lord, your God. What did He do? He reminds us who He is, and then He gave Himself to us. He just says, and now I'm yours. I am yours. And we see this beautiful entrance when we realize He actually fulfilled His promises. Jesus came. He actually came. He didn't just talk about it. Well done, better than well said, right? He came. Then we read this in Matthew. It's so exciting. I get jazzed by it. This is the time of year where they allow me to celebrate and really express what I feel. It's kind of fun. Matthew 21. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets because God promised. Now, of course, it talks about a donkey and, you know, a colt and a mom. So He arranged rental transportation when He got there. And this is to fulfill the prophecy. And, of course, He can only ride on one. But He came. And it says this. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you. You did not have to take one step toward Him. He came to you. Do you know what we have to do oftentimes with the Lord and His great gifts to us? Stand there and try not to drool. He is coming to us. I am the Lord, and here I come. And of course they're going to celebrate. In this moment of epiphany of the people where they actually get it. For 10 minutes, they get it. They celebrate. God has come. See, your king comes to you. Not some brutal force blowing things up, intimidating people to believe in what they believe in. No, that is not our God. That is no God. This is the God who comes. How? Gentle and riding on a donkey. A low state on a colt. On the foal of a donkey. Our God delivers Himself to... I don't think I'm doing this right. I must be screwing up. He came! He really came. He did. He came. And that is huge for us. That's huge for life. That's huge for everything. He came. And so we celebrate. We celebrate. Just like those kids on the ball field, those wonderful challengers who have many difficulties in life as we see it, they have a joy-filled attitude that wherever they see success, no matter who it is or where they see it or when it happens, they celebrate. And they're filled with joy. It's absolutely infectious when you see that group operate. It's absolutely incredible. But not only did he came, boy, what we got was incredible. Because another way that we can celebrate and why we can do this every day is because he is the true, genuine Lord. Our God is the true, genuine Lord. So, some of you know, maybe a lot of you know, I was in the apparel business most of my life. And maybe not at the street level, but I was there and watched, and I was on all sorts of levels of the apparel industry. And it's very interesting. When my grandmother went to shop for apparel, there was maybe four seasons she shopped for. You know, you had spring, summer, fall, and winter. You had four seasons you would shop apparel for. And for many, especially during the difficult times, you had two, right? You had a warm wardrobe, and you had your cold wardrobe, and you set that up. And I think that even lasted through my mom's youth. When I got into the apparel industry, they taught me something different. And they were just beginning to do it when I came in, and now they've perfected it quite well. Do you know how many seasons a year we were trained to prepare for? Throw out a few numbers. What do you think? How many seasons in a year do we prepare for? What do you guys think? Eight, maybe? 10? We were trained to prepare for 52 seasons a year. In other words, we had to make sure that this week's fashion was old by the time the next flyer came out every week. There are 52 seasons in the apparel world. And this is what the world has gone to. And so, because of this, we try and manufacture at the least cost possible, so the real true costs of what we own are kind of hidden in a way. And so we produce just enough quality in an item to be able to get it sold within a week's time. Sometimes it takes longer, but we really shoot for a week's time. And then, after that week's over, we say this, well, that's not on point anymore. That's now unfashionable. You need to be doing this now. It seems crazy, but if you're attuned to it, you'll laugh. You'll just laugh. And you begin to see what goes on. And so this is the mindset that so much of our culture has taken onto. What I have now, I need to dump. It's no longer in fashion. It's no longer on point. And so look at the world now. What happens to the clothes that we wear once or twice and set aside because they're no longer fashionable? You know how much those clothes are worth now? Almost nothing. Zero. And what do we do with a lot of our used clothes? What happens? What do we end up doing with them in the end? Just getting rid of them. There's all these clothing dumps all around town. Some of them go to charity, some of them go to other things. You can't imagine how flush we are with clothing, with apparel, all over the place. It's craziness. At one point in my career, the cost of either just worn once clothes or hardly used clothes had dropped below the price of beans and rice in the store. Because it's not fashionable anymore. We move to the next thing. We stop understanding what the genuine, true value the article is. If that doesn't set in, that's fine. Let's move to something else. How about this? Stop, Siri. See this? It's an iPhone. Even worse, you see what's on my hand? This is the iWatch. Now, I swim. I like to swim. This is the first version. Do you know what the first, second version can do now? It's waterproof. Do you know what I think of my watch now? It's garbage. Since it's not waterproof, it's garbage. And the first chance I get, I'm going to dump this watch and go buy the latest and greatest thing. This has become disposable to me. Yet, does it have a useful life still left in it? Oh my goodness, years. I don't use 1/100th of what this watch can do. I don't know what half of it does. I could use this watch for years, get a good use out of it until it's broken, and then move on. But with our mindset, we have moved on to commodities. We moved on to just simple things. And we crave the next thing to fill our lives. And it's become incredible. To the point where we miss out on the true and genuine. The true and genuine. Have you ever seen lines going for the new iPhone that comes out every year? It's nuts. And as soon as they get the new iPhone, what do they think of the old one? The world has become a world of cravings in which we discard so much. I tell you today, there is no Jesus 2.0. What we have in our Lord who came is the genuine article. It was crafted. It is perfect. It is the Lord thy God. And he delivered this to us. And yet all the other lords in this world scream for our attention. You need something better. You need to throw away that. Things have become so messed up sometimes that we don't see the true genuine article. And when we do, we celebrate it. Look what I got. This is treasured. And so these times of the year in the church, Palm Sunday, Easter, Christmas, we are all but told by the church, smile for goodness sakes. Worship the Lord, raise your hands, celebrate. He came, and he's the genuine article. He's the Lord. He doesn't change his mind. He's going to be with you forever. What a wonderful Lord. And it's so hard sometimes for us. I'm Welsh, but I'm also Scandinavian. Got a lot of that in me from my mom's side. And do you know the tradition that was passed on to me from that northern strain of Lutheranism? Things are good, but they can always be worse. And so I was sort of raised with the mentality of, if something good happens, don't overreact because bad times are coming. And I think that's because you survive through winters, like spring. We know good times are coming, but boy, this brutal life is about to hit us every year. And so we begin to live in this mentality of, But God calls us into celebration, to share this wonderfulness. Those challenger baseball players celebrate life every single day. Yes, back in the day, the Sabbath was once a week and they celebrated the Lord. But now that Jesus has died and was raised again, the Sabbath is every day. And when we see it, we celebrate. I had an aunt growing up that used to do this. I was always so bothered by it. Amen. Amen. Or God bless. God bless. It's so annoying growing up. It's like, come on. I even have one here that could prove that for you. It was just crazy sometimes, right? But I'm starting to get it now. It was a way of saying in every moment to celebrate life as it happens. The life can come and go. It doesn't matter whether we celebrate or lie. The good times come, good times go. But when we have it, we cherish it. We cherish it. Jesus came, we cherish it. And we do everything we can to increase our neighbor's store of it. Yeah? We share it. And we celebrate. We celebrate. And it's so cool because this isn't just one day. What Jesus did and why we can celebrate every day is because he wants an eternal relationship with you. God wants an eternal relationship with you. That's incredible. This isn't a one-time deal. This isn't one baseball game. This isn't just 1-2 weeks a year. Man, we're working on a 365-day cycle with Jesus. All of our life, and he paid the price to get it. This week is about that. We celebrate not knowing what he had to do. And we raise our wonderful palms, and we remember our youth, and we had these two. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest. And we whip and we wave. And in just days, Jesus will be before Pontius Pilate. We will be there soon enough this week. And Pilate questions him. Why are you here? Why are you doing this? Why have you come? Are you a king or what? And Jesus answers, my kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place. So you are a king then, says Pilate. You are a king. Jesus answered, you are right in saying, I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. He is genuine. He is the real deal, and he came. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Listens. And so this week we stop, and I'm going to give you permission. You can whistle in air today. You can walk with whistle in air. You can tap your toe. Wouldn't that be cool? You can smile. You can celebrate. It's a wonderful day. It's Palm Sunday. It's just fill it up and go with it. Enjoy life. Celebrate life. Not just on certain occasions where you're given permission, but as soon as you see it, you celebrate it. Celebrate it. It's a wonderful thing. Why? Because Jesus is with you forever, and he's the genuine article, and he came to you, and he's never going to leave you. So let's celebrate. Let's celebrate. Let's pray.